Hi buddies, I presume that all of you and your families are hale and healthy. It's Professor Suresh, delighted to be back again for my 21st video in process of publication on YouTube today, 27th of May 2020. Topic this time too is an emerging one, which is non-conventional energy sources, way to go. The energy sources can be broadly categorized as renewable and non-renewable resources. Renewable energy sources, also known as non-conventional energy, are sources that are continuously replenished by natural process. A renewable energy system converts the energy found in sunlight, wind, falling water, sea waves, geothermal heat or biomass into a form we can use, such as heat or electricity. Most of the renewable energy comes either directly or indirectly from sun and wind and can never be exhausted, and therefore they are called as renewable. However, most of the world's energy sources are derived from conventional sources, fossil fuels such as coal, oil and natural gases. These fuels are often termed non-renewable energy resources. Although the available quantity of these fuels are extremely large, they are nevertheless finite and so will in principle run out of at some time in the near future. Renewable energy sources are essentially flows of energy, whereas the fossil and nuclear fuels are in essence stocks of energy. Traditional or conventional sources of energy are what we had been using for decades, maybe centuries too. Renewable resources like biomass energy, solar energy, tidal energy, wind energy, hydel power energy, etc. can be regenerated. The non-renewable energy resources like coal, petroleum and natural gas or fossil fuels, which took millions of years to be formed and cannot be renewed during our lifespan. The commercial sources of energy include petroleum, coal, natural gas and nuclear energy. Out of all these, oil is the most widely used energy resource. Oil is the lifeline of global economy. The identified deposits from which oil can be extracted profitably at present prices with the current technology are known as oil resources. 13 countries of the world make up the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, shortly OPEC, O-P-E-C, which have 67% of these reserves. About one-fourth of the oil resources are located in Saudi Arabia. Maximum oil of use is in transportation, 63%, followed by industries, 24%, residential and commercial buildings, 8%, and electric utilities, 8%, as per statistics. At the present rate of consumption, the world's crude oil reserves are estimated to be depleted in 40 years, and there may be enough undiscovered oil lasting for another 40 years. Maximum use of oil is in transportation, as I said, okay. At the present rate of consumption, the world's crude oil reserves are estimated to be depleted in 30 years, not 40 years, and there may be enough undiscovered oil lasting maybe another 20 years, not 40 years. Another 68% of the world's proven and coal reserves and 88% of the estimated undiscovered coal deposits are located in USA, Commonwealth of Independent States, shortly CIS, and China. About 55% of US coal reserves are found west of Mississippi River. Coal is the most abundant conventional fossil fuel in the world. Identified world reserves of coal should last about 200 years as per the estimates. At the current rate of usage and just 60 years, if the rate of usage increases by about 2% per year, about 40% of the world's natural gas reserves are in CIS countries. Other countries with proven natural gas reserves are Iran, 14%, United States, 5%, Qatar, 4%, Saudi Arabia, 3%, and Nigeria, 3%. Geologists expect to find more natural gas, especially in unexplored LDCs. LDC means less developed countries. Most of the natural gas reserves are located in the same area as crude oil. The share of commercial and non-commercial sources of energy in India in the 1980s was in a ratio of 1 to 1. However, following rapid industrial growth, the ratio changed to 4 to 1 in 2000. So much change within a span of 20 years. India has about 5% of world's coal production. Quality of Indian coal is rather poor in terms of heat capacity, that is calorific value, and ash content is also high comparatively. A small quantity of radioactive material can produce an enormous amount of energy. For instance, 1 ton of U-235 would produce as much energy as produced by 3 million tons of coal or 12 million barrels of oil. Thorium is derived from the monazite sands. The major nuclear plants in our country are located in Tarapur, Maharashtra, Kota, Rajasthan, Kalpakkam and Kudankulam in Tamil Nadu, Kakarpara in Gujarat, Kaswa in Karnataka, Narora in Uttar Pradesh. Biomass fuels and animal energy are the two main non-commercial energy sources used in rural India basically. Biomass fuels include fuel wood, crop residues, animal waste and gobar gas, basically from cow dung and even human feces. Petroleum products are used mainly in transport and industrial sector. Enough about conventional sources of energy. The search for alternate sources of energy is strongly rooted in the realization that the conventional energy sources are polluting and they are not renewable and thus limited. Power plays a great role wherever man lives and works. The living standards and prosperity of a nation vary directly with the increase in the use of power. Developed nations use so much power per capita compared to the developing and underdeveloped countries. They are more polluting also in other way. In that sense, the electricity requirement of the world is increasing at an alarming rate due to industrial growth, increased and extensive use of electrical gadgets. Various forms of alternative energy sources are solar, wind, biogas, biomass, tidal, geothermal, fuel cell, hydrogen energy, small hydropower, ocean thermal, ocean mechanical too, fuel cells, magneto-hydrodynamics, etc. Studies indicate that cooking with biogas, a highly combustible fuel comprising mainly methane, carbon dioxide, nitrogen, hydrogen and hydrogen sulfide produced through anaerobic fermentation of organic matter can be cheaper than cooking with any commercial fuel. Prime advantages of alternate energy sources are better lighting, curtails environmental degradation, provides sustainable fuel system, improvement in quality of life by using modern cooking methods, health improvement, enhanced employment opportunities and income, especially in rural areas. Approximately 99% of the energy used to heat our earth and all our buildings comes directly from the sun naturally. Without this direct input of solar energy, our earth's temperature would have been 240 degrees Celsius and life would just not have been possible. The remaining 1% is the commercial energy used by people in different forms like fuel wood, coal, oil, dung, electricity, etc. It is estimated that solar energy is equivalent to over 15,000 times the world's annual energy consumption reaches the earth every year. India receives solar energy in the region of 5 to 7 kilowatt hour per square meter for 300 to 330 days in a year, depending on the location. This energy is sufficient to set up 20 megawatt solar power plant per square kilometer land area. Solar energy can be utilized through two different routes, as solar thermal route and solar photovoltaic routes. Solar thermal route uses the sun's heat to produce hot water or air, cook food, drying materials, etc. Solar photovoltaic uses sun's heat to produce electricity for lighting homes and buildings, running motors, pumps, electrical appliances and lighting. In solar thermal route, solar energy can be converted into thermal energy with the help of solar collectors and receivers known as solar thermal devices. The solar thermal devices can be classified into three categories as 1. Low-grade heating devices up to temperature of 100 degrees Celsius, 2. Medium-grade heating devices, temperatures between 100 to 300 degrees Celsius, 3. High-grade heating devices, temperatures above 300 degrees Celsius. Low-grade solar thermal devices are used in solar water heaters, air heaters, solar cookers and solar dryers for domestic and industrial applications. Solar cooker is a device which uses solar energy for cooking and thus saving fossil fuels, fuel wood and electrical energy to a large extent. However, it can only supplement the cooking fuel and not replace it totally. It's a simple cooking method ideal for domestic cooking during most of the year except during the monsoon season, cloudy days and winter months. Photovoltaic, shortly PV, is the technical term for solar electric. Photo means light and voltaic means electric. PV cells are usually made of silicon, an element that naturally releases electrons when exposed to light. Amount of electrons released from silicon cells depend upon intensity of light incident on it. The silicon cell is covered with a grid of metal that directs the electrons to flow in a path to create an electric current. This current is guided into a wire that is connected to a battery or direct current appliance, shortly DC. Typically, one cell produces about 1.5 watts of power. Individual cells are connected together to form a solar panel or module capable of producing 3 to 100 watts power. Panels can be connected together in series and parallel to make a solar array which can produce any amount of voltage as space will allow. Modules are usually designed to supply electricity at 12 volts. PV modules are rated by their peak watt output at solar noon on a clear day. The performance of a solar cell is measured in terms of its efficiency at converting sunlight into electricity. Only sunlight of certain energy will work efficiently to create electricity, and much of it is reflected or absorbed in the material that makes up the cell. Because of this, a typical commercial solar cell has an efficiency of 15%. As of now, only about 1/6 of the sunlight striking the cell generates electricity, in other words. Low efficiencies mean the larger rays are needed and higher investment costs. It should be noted that the first solar cells built in the 1950s had efficiency of less than 4%. So we have come a long way. Presently it is around 15%, 1/5. In solar water pumping system, the pump is driven by an electric motor run by solar electricity instead of conventional electricity drawn from utility grid. A solar PV, SPV, water pumping system consists of photovoltaic array mounted on a stand and a motor pump set compatible with the PV array. It converts the solar energy into electricity which is used for running the motor pump set. Wind energy is basically harnessing of wind power to produce electricity. The kinetic energy of the wind is converted into electrical energy. When solar radiation enters the Earth's atmosphere, different regions of the atmosphere are heated to different degrees because of the Earth's curvature. This heating is higher at equator and lowest at the poles. Since air tends to flow from warmer to cooler regions, this causes what we call winds. And it is these air flows that are harnessed in windmills and wind turbines to produce electric power. Biomass is a renewable energy resource derived from the carbonaceous waste of various human and natural activities. It is derived from numerous resources, including the byproducts from the wood industry, agricultural crops, raw material from the forest, household waste, etc. Biomass does not add carbon dioxide to the atmosphere, as it absorbs the same amount of carbon in growing as it releases when consumed as a fuel. Its advantage is that it can be used to generate electricity with the same equipment that is now being used for burning fossil fuels. Biomass is an important source of energy and the most important fuel worldwide after coal, oil and natural gas. Bioenergy in the form of biogas, which is derived from biomass, is expected to become one of the key energy resources for global sustainable development. Biomass offers higher energy efficiency through form of biogas than by direct burning. Biogas is a clean and efficient fuel generated basically from cow dung or human waste or any kind of biological materials derived through anaerobic fermentation process. The biogas consists of 60% methane with the rest mainly carbon dioxide. Biogas is a safe fuel for cooking and lighting. Byproduct is usable as high-grade manure fertilizer. The process of densifying loose agro-waste into a solidified biomass of higher density, which can be conveniently used as a fuel, is called biomass briquetting. Briquette is also termed as biocoal. It's pollution-free and eco-friendly. Some of the agricultural and forestry residues can be briquetted after suitable pre-treatment. A list of commonly used biomass materials that can be briquetted are corn cob, jute stick, sawdust, pine needle, bagasse, coffee spent, tamarind, coffee husk, almond shell, groundnut shells, coir pith, bagasse pith, barley straw, tobacco dust, rice husk, de-oil bran. Biomass briquettes can replace almost all conventional fuels like coal, firewood and lignite in almost all general applications like heating, steam generation, etc. It can be used directly as fuel instead of coal in the traditional ovens and furnaces or in the gasifier. Gasifier converts solid fuel into a more convenient to use gaseous form of fuel called producer gas. Biopower or biomass power is the use of biomass to generate electricity. There are 6 major types of biopower systems: direct fire, co-firing, gasification, anaerobic digestion, pyrolysis, and small modular. Most of the biopower plants in the world are direct fire system. They burn bioenergy feedstocks directly in boiler to produce steam. This steam drives the turbo generator. In some industries, the steam is also used in manufacturing process or to heat the buildings. These are known as combined heat and power facilities. For example, wood waste is often used to produce both electricity and steam at paper mills. Many coal-fired power plants use co-firing systems to significantly reduce emissions, especially sulfur dioxide emissions. Co-firing involves using bioenergy feedstock as a supplementary fuel source in high-efficiency boilers. Gasification systems use high temperatures and an oxygen-starved environment to convert biomass into a gas, which is a mixture of hydrogen, carbon monoxide, and methane. The gas fuels a gas turbine, which runs an electric generator for producing the power. The decay of biomass produces methane gas, which can be used as energy source. Methane can be produced from biomass through a process called anaerobic digestion. Anaerobic digestion involves using bacteria to decompose organic matter in the absence of oxygen. In landfills, scientific waste disposal site, wells can be drilled to release a methane from the decaying organic matter. Even some houses, they are generating methane this way from the kitchen waste and all that. The pipes from each well carry the gas to a central point where it is filtered and cleaned before burning. Methane can be used as an energy source in many ways. Most facilities burn it in a boiler to produce steam for electricity generation or for industrial process. 2 new ways include the use of micro turbines and fuel cells. Micro turbines have outputs of 25 to 500 kilowatts. About the size of a refrigerator, they can be used where there are space limitations for power production. Methane can also be used as a fuel in a fuel cell. Fuel cell works much like batteries but never needs recharging, producing electricity as long as there is fuel. It's basically from chemical reaction that occurs. In addition to gas, liquid fuels can be produced from biomass through a process called pyrolysis. Pyrolysis occurs when biomass is heated in the absence of oxygen. The biomass then turns into liquid called pyrolysis oil. Nowadays they are generating oil from plastics also this way. This can be burned like petroleum to generate electricity. A biopower system that uses pyrolysis oil is being commercialized. Several biopower technologies can be used in small modular systems. A small modular system generates electricity at a capacity of 5 megawatts or less. This system is designed for use at the small town level or even at the consumer level. For example, some farmers use the waste from their livestock to provide the farms with electricity. Not only do these systems provide renewable energy, they also help farmers meet the environmental regulations. Cogeneration improves viability and profitability of sugar industries. Indian sugar mills are rapidly turning to biogas. The leftover of cane after it is crushed and its juice extracted to generate electricity. Actually, it's a byproduct. This is mainly being done to clean up the environment, cut down power costs, and earn additional revenue. Another useful byproduct is ethyl alcohol from the sugar mills, ethanol, which is even used in sanitizers currently for COVID-19. According to current estimates, about 3,500 megawatt of power can be generated from biogas in the existing 400 sugar mills in the country. Hydro energy is a conversion of potential energy of falling water, captured and converted to mechanical energy by water wheels, also called as turbines, which is then used to run the generator to generate electricity. This powered the start of the industrial revolution, hydel power. Tidal electricity generation, tidal, involves the construction of a barrage dam across an estuary to block the incoming and outgoing tide. The head of water is then used to drive turbines to generate electricity from the elevated water in the basin, as in hydroelectric dams. Ocean energy draws on the energy of ocean waves, tides, or on the thermal energy, the heat stored in the ocean. The sun warms the surface water a lot more than the deep ocean water, and this temperature difference stores thermal energy. The ocean contains two types of energy: thermal energy from the sun's heat and mechanical energy from the tides and waves. Ocean mechanical energy is quite different from ocean thermal energy. Even though the sun affects all ocean activity, tides are driven primarily by the gravitational pull of the moon, and waves are driven primarily by the winds. A barrage dam is typically used to convert the tidal energy into electricity by forcing the water through turbines, activating a generator. Basically, if we harness a solar energy by 10%, it will be more than enough to take care of the global energy requirement. Solar energy is available in abundance in so many tropical countries like India. Presently, solar energy conversion methods are not cost-effective, hence usage is limited, but it is improving. Wind energy is not a reliable source since there are limitations on minimum speed and maximum speed for wind energy conversion systems. Availability of geothermal energy is limited. Availability of tidal wave energy is also limited. Ocean thermal energy conversion, shortly OTEC, OTEC systems, are not commercially viable. There is good scope for energy conversion from biomass, fuel cells, hydrogen, and also magnetohydrodynamics, but the progress is very slow. Countries whose economy is based on fossil fuels, besides companies that thrive on fossil fuels like oil refineries, are main barriers to effective utilization of renewable sources of energy. Methane is quite promising. Solar energy is one of the most resourceful sources of energy for the future. One of the reasons for this is that the total energy we receive each year from the sun is around 35,000 times the total energy used by man. However, about one-third of this energy is either absorbed by the outer atmosphere or reflected back into the space, a process called albedo. Solar energy is the energy force that sustains life on the earth for all plants, animals, and people. The earth receives this radiant energy from the sun in the form of electromagnetic waves, which the sun continuously emits into space. The earth is essentially a huge solar energy collector, receiving large quantities of this energy, which manifests itself in various forms, such as direct sunlight used through photosynthesis by plants, heated air masses causing wind and evaporation of the oceans, resulting as rain, which can form rivers. The solar energy can be tapped directly as solar energy thermal and photovoltaic, and indirectly as wind, biomass, water power, wave energy, and ocean temperature difference. Solar energy is a renewable resource that is inexhaustible and is locally available. It is a clean energy source, green energy, that allows for local energy independence. The sun's power flow reaching the earth is typically about 1000 watts per square meter, although availability varies with the location and time of the year. Capturing solar energy typically requires equipment with a relatively high initial cost. However, over the lifetime of the solar equipment, these systems can prove to be cost competitive as compared to conventional energy technologies. The key to successful solar energy installation is to use quality components that have long lifetimes and require minimum maintenance. Electricity can be produced from sunlight through direct heating of fluids to generate steam for large-scale centralized electrical generation, called as solar thermal electrical generation. The electricity can alternately be produced from sunlight through a process called photovoltaic PV, which can be applied in either a centralized or decentralized fashion. The unique aspect of PV is that it is a radical or disruptive type of technology as compared to conventional power generation technologies. PV allows people the opportunity to ignore traditional electrical power supply structures and meet their own power needs locally. Even in India, some of the residential complexes are using solar PV cells to generate the electricity that they need, at least to a certain extent, and the excess can be fed to the government grid and all that. The best performing renewable energy electrification systems are those that meet the expectations of the users. It is important to satisfy the basic needs of the user in order to ensure acceptance of renewable energy systems. For many applications, especially remote site and small power applications, PV power is the most cost-effective option available, not to mention its environmental benefits, being green energy in the sense there is hardly any pollution like thermal power plants, and very safe as compared to nuclear power plants. Just recall the major accidents at nuclear power plants like Daiichi in Japan recently, Chernobyl in Ukraine, Three Mile Island in USA. These areas are completely barren and deserted. PV conversion efficiencies have increased with the commercially available modules that are from 12 to 17%, 17% efficient, I said 15% on the average, and research laboratory cells demonstrate efficiencies above 34%. That is under development. A well-designed PV system will operate unattended and requires minimum periodic maintenance, which can result in significant labor savings. PV modules available in the market today are guaranteed by the manufacturer from 10 to 25 years life and should last well over 30 years. Actually, Chinese have come up with a very cost-effective PV cells. PV conversion efficiencies and manufacturing process will continue to improve, causing prices to gradually decrease. However, no dramatic overnight price breakthroughs are expected. PV is the best suited for remote site applications that are small to moderate power requirements or small power consuming applications, even when the grid is in existence. A few power companies are also promoting limited grid connected PV systems, but the large market for this technology is for standalone, what we call as off-grid applications. In India, there is a big solar power plant of capacity 250 megawatts in operation in Bhadla, Rajasthan. Another big one is coming up. It's in the process. Pumping water is one of the most competitive areas for PV power since it is simple, reliable, and requires almost no maintenance. Solar cookers are also in usage, but not in a big way. PV-powered packaged evaporative cooling units are commercially available and takes advantage of the natural relation that when maximum cooling is required is when maximum solar energy is available. See, that is natural. These units are most appropriate for comfort cooling in the dry climate of West Texas, where performance is the best. Direct evaporative coolers save 70% of the energy over refrigerated units. Battery storage is obviously required if cooler operation is desired at night. Array size could vary with the power requirements of the cooler motor, a direct current booster, linear current booster, shortly LCB, is useful between the PV modules and the cooler's direct current DC motor if the cooler is occupied, coupled directly to the PV array. Telecommunications was one of the early important markets for PV technologies and continues to be an important market. You know, all the satellites in space are powered by solar arrays only. There are solar cars too, solar powered cars. Isolated mountain tops and other rural areas are ideal for standalone PV systems, where maintenance and power accessibility makes PV the ideal technology. These are often large systems, sometimes placed in hybrid applications with propane or other types of generators. Solar powered watches, calculators and cameras are all everyday applications for PV technologies. Typically, these applications use amorphous PV technologies that work well in artificial light environments such as offices and classrooms. Solar energy storage systems are readily available in the market. Solar water heaters, PV self-powered lights, fans, etc. are quite handy in rural areas. The ocean is a natural reservoir of solar power and could be used as a source for thermal energy. If we can draw warm water from the surface and cold water from the depths, an ocean thermal power plant could operate 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, non-stop. There are also the hybrid systems. Wyoming, USA has a system that holds backwater and a neighboring hydroelectric plant when the wind is blowing, which for the time being runs the turbines. The World Bank has a program to install home lighting system in 200,000 homes in Indonesia. Why not in India? The use of silicon crystals in the PV cells makes it expensive. First of all, silicon crystals were assembled manually. Secondly, silicon purification is difficult. As a matter of fact, they are fabricating silicons in space now to avoid this, and a lot of silicon is wasted. In addition, the operation of silicon cells requires a cooling system because performance degrades at high temperatures. However, it has convinced analysts that solar cells will become a significant source of energy by the end of this century. With a vision of clean and abundant energy for all, United States Industrial Development Organization, Industrial Center for Hydrogen Energy Technologies, shortly UNIDO, ICHET, Turkey, is doing a serious effort through energy institutes established to harness hydrogen energy and promote its widespread usage. International Association for Hydrogen Energy, shortly IAHE, Florida, USA, was founded with the aim of helping to convert the world to the hydrogen economy by informing energy and environmental scientists, politicians and decision makers along with the general public. As hydrogen is to be produced from water, it is supposed to be one of the lightest, most efficient, cost-effective and cleanest fuel on the planet if the manual technology is developed. This is realistic since over 72% of the globe is covered with water and byproduct again is water. In other words, hydrogen economy starts and ends with water. It can avoid all harmful gases, acid rains, pollutants, ozone depleting chemicals and oil spillages due to conventional fuels. Use of hydrogen can afford the development of clean and adequate energy for sustainable development of all. Hydrogen is the simplest element. An atom of hydrogen consists of only one proton and one electron. It is also the most plentiful element in the universe. Despite the simplicity and abundance, hydrogen does not occur naturally as a gas on the earth. It is always combined with other elements, so we need to separate it from the other elements. Water, for example, is a combination of hydrogen and oxygen. Two atoms of hydrogen, one atom of oxygen. Hydrogen is also found in many organic compounds, notably the hydrocarbons that make up many of our fuels, such as gasoline, natural gas, methanol, and propane. Liquid hydrogen should be stored at low temperatures, called as cryogenic conditions. Hydrogen is currently stored in tanks as a compressed gas or cryogenic liquid. The tanks can be transported by trucks. The compressed gas can be sent across distances of less than 50 miles per pipeline. There is a safety issue also because it is explosive. You must have heard about hydrogen bombs and all that. Hydrogen is high in energy, yet an engine that burns pure hydrogen produces almost no pollution. NASA, National Aeronautics and Space Administration, USA, has used liquid hydrogen since the 1970s to propel the space shuttle and other rockets into orbit. Hydrogen fuel cells power the shuttle's electrical systems, producing a clean byproduct, pure water, which the crew drinks. You can think of a fuel cell as a battery that is constantly replenished by adding fuel to it. It never loses its charge. Fuel cells are a promising technology for use as a source of heat and electricity for buildings and as an electrical power source for electrical vehicles. A lot of developed countries are using fuel cell technologies for even powering their vehicles as well as to generate the required electricity for their houses and all that. They are not dependent on either the government supplied electricity or the private companies supplied electricity, even in USA and all that. Although these applications would ideally run off pure hydrogen in the near future, they are likely to be fueled with natural gas, methanol, or even gasoline. Reforming these fuels to create hydrogen will allow the use of much of our current energy infrastructure, gas stations, natural gas pipelines, etc., while fuel cells are phased in. In the future, hydrogen would also join electricity as an important energy carrier. An energy carrier stores, moves, and delivers energy in a usable form to consumers. Renewable energy sources like the sun can't produce energy all the time. The sun does not always shine, but hydrogen can store this energy until it is needed and can be transported to where it is needed. In my opinion, solar, biogas, biomass, ocean, and hydrogen are viable energy resources with a vast potential to surface global supply energy requirement if harnessed optimally. Viewers who are more keen, curious for more elaborate information, by browse digital information besides research articles on this topic. Even Indian government is offering a lot of subsidies, provides a lot of motivation to people to generate the electricity that they need using mainly solar PV arrays. We'll meet again real soon. Rest in peace and harmony. Always watch these videos with closed caption, CC, subtitles for enhanced comprehension. I know pretty well that I rushed through to complete the presentation within 20 minutes maximum because the human's attention span is very limited. Anyhow, this time the topic was such that I had to cover it more elaborately, and hence, definitely I exceeded the time limit I had set myself. My sincere apologies to my dedicated fans. Take care. Bye.